Fusion is the power of the stars. It's what powers the sun, and it really is the most powerful form of energy in the entire universe.
We're replicating that on Earth.
The world needs fusion. We need sustainable ways of producing low-carbon electricity. Fusion, in many ways, is the ultimate energy source.
Imagine if you have 1 liter of fusion fuel. That's equivalent to 10 million liters of oil.
The benefits that you are going to get from fusion are really, really amazing.
In many ways, it could completely transform society as we know it. I think fusion is one of the greatest challenges that humanity has ever undertaken.
It's no longer the energy of the future. It's happening now.
It is estimated that there will be a 265% increase in electricity demand by 2050. In that same short time frame, we need to decarbonize across all sectors. Fusion offers answers to these challenges, but can it happen in time?
Well, the vision for fusion energy is so compelling. It offers not only green baseload power for electricity, but also the means to decarbonize some of the hardest to abate industries. Think about how we're producing our sustainable fuels, how we're making steel, how we're producing petrochemicals in the future. These industries don't need electricity so much, they need high-grade heat. Fusion is an excellent source of that. But when we come to electricity, we have the ever-growing power of societies requiring more and more electrification, but then you have the impact of AI, data centers, high-performance computing. We must get an answer for this dilemma. If we don't do that, and we answer climate change, we have to actually take a step backwards. So fusion allows us to keep the progress and growth around the world.
Not only do you need to get to net zero by 2050, you need to sustain it. So in order to sustain net zero targets, I think fusion is going to be essential. So fusion in many ways is the ultimate energy source, right? It's low carbon, it doesn't produce any carbon. It's inherently safe, it's sustainable. It would work in all jurisdictions, every country in the world. It's completely equitable, completely just, and that's really exciting, right? It could completely revolutionise the whole energy market.
Harnessing the same energy that powers the sun is now a reality, in the lab at least. So how exactly does it work?
So there's a number of different approaches to fusion energy, but ultimately, what's required for all of these is a good understanding of the fusion process itself, the physics of that. Fusion is the power of the stars, and so creating fusion energy is, while conceptually very simple, in practice very difficult. At the incredible temperature and pressures at the center of the star, you get the two lightest atoms in the universe, hydrogen, and at those conditions, they're put together and combined to form the next heavier atom, which is helium. And in that process, you release an incredible amount of energy. And that energy can be harnessed to provide the power that's going to support the energy transition to a more sustainable future.
To make fusion happen, you need very high temperatures and very high pressures. And we use magnetic fields to compress plasma. What happens inside that plasma when you get to these conditions? Is you force two light isotopes of hydrogen to fuse together. And when they do that, they make helium and they release a neutron, which is the energy that becomes fusion power.
The science of fusion practically is mature. A lot of the technologies that have been developed and proven in laboratories and in large-scale science experiments where the fundamentals of this thing work. And with that in hand, we can actually now pivot to focusing on the commercialization.
A viable, commercially scaled fusion industry is the ultimate goal for everyone in the sector. Getting there is fraught with challenges.
Think about what you're doing here. You're taking a fuel and making it 10 times hotter than the center of the sun. Then you have to extract the heat because it's so hot, right? You can't allow it to touch the walls of the vessel or it would just instantly melt. So you have to really think cleverly about how you're going to extract the heat. That's a pretty unforgiving environment. So you can't really send people into that environment. So to maintain the machine, you need some pretty complex robotics. You have to think about how you're going to keep putting fuel in And our fuel is deuterium, which we just take from seawater, and tritium. So the establishment and the supply of tritium is a big challenge. As it fuses, that fuel releases neutrons. And as those neutrons move through the material that you've built the plant from, the steel, they will change the properties of that steel, change its lifetime and actually degrade it. So that's a big challenge. Now, any one of those things is a hard challenge, but integrating them at the same time is a really, really hard challenge, right? So that's why we don't have fusion, because we haven't quite bottomed out all of those challenges yet.
Another challenge is to debunk some lingering myths, which can slow progress and deprive the sector of broader support and investor confidence.
We need to educate people and show them just how big this prize is, but also bust some of the myths that exist out there. Everything from believing it's the same as nuclear fission to, you know, creating black holes in the future and a lot of trepidation. Whereas essentially a fusion device has an inherent fail-safe built into it.
The fusion process is completely clean. It emits no carbon dioxide, no greenhouse gases. There's no long-term nuclear waste from this. I think the biggest myth, which is something that's really been grounded in the fact that it's taken society a half a century to get to the point where we are now ready to commercialize it, is that the commercial opportunity for fusion is still a long way off. Things are happening so quickly in the fusion sector right now, it's almost hard to keep up with what's happening. There have been a number of really, really important milestones that have been achieved over the past 3 to 5 years. Fusion is now starting to use AI to improve the design of fusion machines, to actually help control the fusion process. 3D printing, advanced manufacturing, high temperature superconducting magnets. Well, we are starting to do that in the fusion industry now, is apply these capabilities, these industrial capabilities, to the commercialization of fusion.
So let me introduce you to ST40. This is our spherical tokamak, and this is an incredible machine. So yeah, think of ST40 as containing a small star or a sun here on Earth. In February of 2022, we're just a short distance away from what was the hottest temperature in the solar system on that day. You're using very, very powerful magnets to compress and shape a plasma. And we held that plasma. We were able to heat it up to 100 million degrees Celsius. And that is the threshold temperature for fusion. Here are the fuel tanks for ST40. And maybe you can get a scale of the size of the canisters of deuterium that we're using.
So just this amount of fuel in this small fuel tank allows you to produce temperatures exceeding the sun?
Yes. Yeah, routinely at tens of millions of degrees Celsius. And the great news is ST40 is not done yet. And we're just mapping out a multi-year program that will continue to close out key science gaps. So ST40 will still be giving us learning that we take into our future devices and making fusion happen.
From lab to pilot to commercialization, what's needed to scale up fusion?
Our mission is very much about working with industrial partners, trying to develop a whole landscape, actually build a sector that can then deliver fusion power plants in the future. So fusion power plants ultimately will end up looking like conventional power plants, actually. They'll be more or less the same footprint as a gas plant. Now, whilst in a way that's quite boring, in another way, that's really good because we know that technology, we've been using it for 200 years. And so the scalability of fusion into the market is almost predetermined. We know the rate at which we can build plants of that scale, of that sort of infrastructure. Actually, already there's quite a lot of infrastructure that we can reuse. Here in the UK, we announced a couple of years ago that the first prototype power plant that we're building will be built on the site of a former coal power station. So we benefit then from the connection to the grid, from the cooling water pumping station, from a railway line to bring in goods and people, from the substations. All of that stuff is already there. So you get a running start because you already have that infrastructure in place. And the fact that fusion can benefit from that means it should be able to roll out a bit quicker.
What is happening in this decade is that we have a number of big experiments that will end up in the construction of pilot plants. A pilot plant is not a commercial plant, but it's the closest that we can get. By the end of the decade, so at the beginning of the 30s, we should be able to have pilot plants, and this is close to a commercial plant. And in the next decade, commercial plants will develop, with all the scale economies associated to that and so on. So we are moving. It's no longer the energy of the future. It's happening now.
Humanity has always progressed. It's what we do. Fusion offers an inviting panacea, but how much finance is needed to make it real?
Fusion will be capitally intensive. It will require many billions and probably tens of billions to build prototype power plants.
The prize of fusion is absolutely immense, both for the future of the planet and humanity, and the economic prize as well. And the race is on. So what was a government lab-driven R&D is now being picked up by private fusion companies. Now we're starting to see the two blend together in public-private partnerships. It is going to cost money, clearly. And when we think about where we spend money in the world, is it a good investment decision? Of course it is. The prize that we're aiming for is a $10 trillion market for fusion.
We can do a better job of explaining the benefits today. So I think investment would be more catalyzed if we said, you're not just betting on a 30-year horizon, you're already going to get benefits in the next 5 years because we're developing technology which can be applied in other sectors. There's somewhere between $8 and $9 billion now invested in fusion companies, in fusion startups. And actually a lot of that is predicated upon the fact that they do get adjacent benefits and they can sell product into other markets. So you're not just betting on jam tomorrow, you're getting jam today as well.
The prize of fusion is tantalizingly close. Measuring incremental steps as well as the revolutionary breakthroughs will unlock finance and accelerate the reality of fusion.
How to measure the progress of fusion and how to make it happen is through data and well-established parameters, where you can say this is at the lab state or this is a commercial state, basically, and there is a scale. So you need to standardize and apply to your concept and show to your investor or whoever you need to show how fast or not you are progressing. If you don't have that data, you cannot jump. And if you cannot jump, you are not progressing.
The science of fusion is no longer a fiction. Moving from the lab to a pilot plant will be critical if this new energy source is to scale. But how soon before fusion is an everyday reality?
How soon will fusion be a reality? This is always the question, and everyone wants a precise answer.
We're focused on deploying the first fusion pilot power plants over the next decade so that by the second half of the 2030s, we're really ready to scale fusion energy aggressively and globally in order to continue the transition to net zero carbon.
Fusion will be a reality within the next 2 decades for sure. And I'm fully convinced on that.
So fusion is being developed now. It's a pilot plant in the mid-2030s. The 2040s is when this really scales. And so we are dealing with a technology that is there to hit decarbonisation goals in 2050.
That's a long way into the future, I'm afraid. I do think we'll have fusion power plants that produce electricity by 2050, but I don't think we'll have very many of them. But we are making real tangible progress.
So fusion is happening now, but we may have to wait until the second half of the 21st century before it is on a grid near you, and with it, the promise of prosperity for all humanity.
I don't see a future to a truly sustainable energy economy without fusion energy.
No longer is energy about who has access to what they can dig out of the ground, which is basically how our whole society works today. It would be about who has access to technology. It's a completely different paradigm for where we get the electricity that powers our lives.
And there are very, very few things you can do where you can say, this will transform humanity in the future. And that's fusion for me.